Data on the behalf of Dr. Muhammad Afzal from Kuwait University. As the title of the conference is From Basics to Applied. So Dr. Afzal has aptly selected the topic of the today presentation from plant root to the cancer root. Actually, there are certain plants, there are mostly compounds that are obtained from the plant that are being used for the treatment of the cancer. We will discuss, I will introduce few of them. For your knowledge. Before starting the lecture, it's a bit summary of the lecture. In this seminar lecture, we will cover an overview of the anti-cancer natural product. These include terpenoids, flavonoids, simple phenolic acids, quinones. Then we have alkana, tinctoria, and finally we will conclude our discussion. Starting with the definition of cancer, cancer could be defined as it's an abnormal cell growth, uncontrolled cell growth. It may be results of some mutation and some other physical, chemical, heredity factors that has already been discussed in previous talks. Cancer is the leading cause of the death. About 12 million cancer cases have been reported, and about among them 7 million deaths were there in 2008. And it could reach into 11.4 million in 2030. More than two-thirds of the anti-cancer, anti-neoplastic drugs come from the natural sources. Regarding the natural sources, we have world flora. About the world flora, we have angiospermic plant with 300,000 to 500,000 and marine species greater than 2 million. And about 10% of the plants and about few of marine species resources have been still discovered and investigated for their chemical potentials or pharmacological potentials, or all these constitute about 800,000 total world flora. What are the anti-neoplastic drugs? These are the drugs that can be used for the treatment of cancers. Natural product offer a great potential for anti-cancer molecules. It is believed that 2 to 4% hard plant and since 10% marine species. It's very surprising that marine species could produce the anti-cancer drugs, and we can isolate them, these drugs from them. Species sensitized into neoplastic or cytotoxic drugs. Starting the introduction of terpenoids, this is the class of chemical compound that come from the natural sources of plant. The basic formula is C5H8. This unit C5 carbon 5 is called isoprene units, and if there are two isoprene units, that is called monoterpenes, and these include limonene, eugenol, and citrulline, citrol, etc. etc. 37 monoterpenes are reported to be anti-cancer in nature. Then sesquiterpenes, they have three isoprene units and they can be obtained from plants as well as from microorganisms and marine sources. Derivatives are cytotoxic. And then again, if four isoprene units unite together, this is called as diterpenes contained. And the best known example is taxol. And this taxol is, this is the example of some vascoline sesquiterpenes from Curcuma longa, which is belonging to family Zingiberaceae. And this is isocurcumanol and procurcumanol and limonone structures. This is the diterpene units A, B, C, D, 4. When isoprene units unite together, they form the taxol. Taxol is a plant-derived anti-cancer drug. It's obtained from the Pacific yew tree that is called a Texas bryophilia, Texas chinensis, Texas baqueta, etc. Mm-hmm. They can have the potential. And many parts of the Texas plants like needles, bark, they can yield the Texas. Taxol anti-tumor activity we'll talk about. It is the cytotoxic as well as anti-tumor drug. It is being used widely in ovarian cancer, breast and lung cancer, prostate, head and neck cancer. The other anti-mitotic agents, vincristine, that is obtained from Manuka arosea, colchicine, colchicomatum nail, podophyllotoxin, podophyllum species, mycenicin, Mycenis ovata and rhizopsin, the fungus rhizopsin enhances, that can produce the rhizopsin. These are the examples in Christian and Blossom, the molecular structures. And these are the few core structures, colchicine obtained from colchicomatum nail, rhizopsin, podophyllotoxin. Then marine, that is the other source, basic source for the production of anti-cancer drugs. We have the stabilizing agent, the anti-mitotic agents from the marine sources include viscodermolide obtained from viscodermia rugosa. It's a staunch type. The molecular formula and the molecular is given over here. And dolacetin, 10. Another important class taken off from the nature sources, that is quinones. And quinones are alpha, beta, diketones derived from the acetate malonate pathway. And another source of the ketones, the biosynthetic pathway ketones, includes Sycamates pathway. Some also occur as glycosides. About 600 natural quinones are known. Half come from the rubaceae family of plant. Quinones are intermediates in many pathway of genes regulations, enzyme protein induction, feedback control, waste product management, electron transport chain, etc. They're very important for the various body functions. Ubiquinones are mitochondrial reductase. They're involved in the production of energy during the electron transport chain. If we classify the quinones, we can classify into various groups: benzoquinone, naphthoquinones, anthroquinones, about 200 compounds, and then we have phenanthroquinones, etc. And this is Nigelia sativa, and important, it can produce thymoquinone and dithymoquinone. This is the naphthoquinone, their physiological activity. Physiologically, they are present in the body as ubiquinone, plastoquinones, and vitamin K. They are very functional constituent of the biochemical systems. And if they would come to the biological activity, they act as antibacterial, antifungal, antineoplastic, insecticidals. Cytotoxic activity have also been reported regarding by two functions, by two ways, the inhibitions of electron transport chain and uncouplers of the oxidative phosphorylation. Then we have naphthoquinones are present in the several families of the hair plant. These are the name of the certain families that can produce the naphthoquinones, and they include algae, fungi and bacteria as well. Simple naphthoquinone with pharmacological activity, lapacol anti-trypanosomal, and then we have jugolon. It's obtained from walnut plant, anti-tumor activity, have antibacterial, antifungal, antidiarrheal, antihelminthic, and immunostimulating, etc., various pharmacological actions. And we have lason. It's obtained from henna and is being used since 2000 year back, UV absorbent, mostly used in sunscreens. Derivatives are antibacterial, antifungal, so many actions of the lason. Then we have plumbagen,
It is used as in leprosy, anti-leprotic agent, tuberculosis, and antimicrobial, anti-malarial agents. These are the few structures regarding these compounds. Then, this is the reactive oxygen species and quinones. In cancer cells, proliferation is increased by reactive oxygen species. These are the certain chemical radicals which are being produced by the cells. Naturally, they are scavenged by glutathione and can be scavenged by glutathione, thyroxine, SOD, and catalase. And cancer cells have more metabolic activity, greater concentration RS than normal cells. So it was discovered that when we use quinones along with the ROS, reactive oxygen species, that they can induce the apoptosis resulting in the cell death. So cell control is enhanced. This is the compound and mechanisms. So we have common chemotherapeutic agent that can DNA damage, so ROS, and resulting into the deaths. The other mechanism that is being assisted by the quinolones and ROS. This is the mechanism of formation of superoxide 9. This is such type of chemical compound that can reverse the activity, cancerous activity. These are the certain compounds, the quinones, which are under clinical trials: mitomycin, trapezamine, amoxan, phenytoin, and some other compound which are being under investigations under clinical trials. So this is the Arnebia tinctoria belonging to Borgeniaceae. That's called Bedouin ethnobotany. This is the species, and this is the part used and the plant which were being investigated for their anti-cancer activities. Borgeniaceae family, one of the largest family of the flowering plant, 148 genera and 2700 species. Many species are poisonous. The inhabitants mostly present in the Colombia, Venezuela, Mexico, USA, and Arabian Peninsula. This is the biological active naphthoquinones in Borgeniaceae family. Naphthoquinones are the mutagenic in micro salmonella and microsome test. Mutagenicity depend upon the substitution, how they're going to combine with the different chemicals in the body. They are potential pest control agents by inhibiting ATC electron transport in the pest. Many Borgeniaceae plants containing quinones are used in the treatment of various diseases such as antibacterial, antifungal, antiviral, anti-tumor, etc. These are the considered privileged structure in medicinal chemistry due to their biological activity. This is due to their ease of reduction. They can be reduced to semi-quinones or quinoles, so that being easily used for their activities. Beta-lipocon is cytotoxic to a variety of human cancer: breast, lung, pancreas, colon, and prostate. It is in phase 2 trial, under clinical trial, still not marketed. Synergistic action, combination of action, 2 plus 2 usually make 4. When we talk about synergistic action, it means 2 plus 2 make 5. So it's a synergistic effect. Effect is enhanced by the collective effect. Action with taxol and genistein on several tumor cells lines. DNA topoisomerase 1 was the first biochemical target to be reported by this compound. These are the structures. Then naphthoquinones in Arnebia tinctoria, a total 52 naphthoquinones, monomers, dimers, and trimers with variable acyl groups in the side chains have been detected. This is chiconine, a compound that is being obtained. If we have an R group on upper parts, if R group is going to be changed, the derivatives can be formed, and these derivatives have the potential effect. Then again, the ketone form and enol form. This is chiconine dimers. This is chiconine trimers. Biological activity of chiconine and its derivative. They were observed and investigated in the laboratory. Acetyl chiconine is known to inhibit eicosanoid production, attenuation of cytosolic phosphatase, phospholipase A2. and blockage of cyclooxygenase and lipoxygenate activity. It block in this way it work. These are the different cancer cell lines which were being used for the estimation of anti-cancer activity of fecund in their derivatives. This is the conditions or media which were prepared. Media context consists of RPM 16 140 sigma supplemented with 10% FBS sigma, 1 millimolar non-essential amino acid, 1 millimolar sodium pyruvate, 100 unit per ml penicillin and 100 microgram per ml streptomycin. Cells were incubated 37 degrees centigrade in humidified atmosphere with 5% carbon dioxide. Results showed that with the increasing the concentration, the cytotoxic activity increased, and they have all the derivative and chikonin both have the effect on the their activity on different cell lines. All cell lines or all type of cancer could be treated, but dose could be different from one to another. These are the reference. Concluding, our result shows a great potential of Erinibia tinctoria as a source of anti-cancer compound from plant abundantly available in Kuwait deserts. It was teamwork by Dr. Almaya Hayat, Anwar Al Musawi and Jacqueline Rose.
Thank you Dr. M. Afzal and thank you Dr. Umar for presenting it. Highly impressive work. Now we would like to start the speaker sessions with the presentations, but I have a request to make before that we are already going shortage of time. So it will be better if you are going to be very concise, keep to the core objective, and the time limit given to you for each presentation is 5 minutes. Please.
First of all, I would like to invite Dr. Saima Sharif from Department of Zoology, Lahore College for Women University, to deliver the presentation on behalf of Dr. Muhammad Saqib from Bundaberg Hospital, Australia. The topic of her presentation is thyroid hormone status in euthyroid arterial fibrillation subjects in our local population.
Assalamu alaikum. The topic of the presentation is just described, that is the thyroid hormone status in euthyroid arterial fibrillation subjects from our local population. The cardiac diseases, among the cardiac diseases, atrial fibrillation is a common disorder that arises frequently in our general population. It is defined as supraventricular cardiac arrhythmia, which is characterized by uncoordinated atrial activation with subsequent deterioration of the heart muscles. Atrial fibrillation is an ordinary disease of the heart with extremely irregular rhythm. And it regulates because it arises because there is uncontrollable electrical signals which produces ultimately irregular heartbeats. In our general population, the prevalence is 0.4 to 1%. It is a complex cardiovascular disease with severe consequences, which includes heart failure, stroke, and also it doubles the risk of death. Thyroid hormones, there is a thyroid gland which produces two important hormones, that was triiodothyronine and tetraiodothyronine, that is T3 and T4. The cardiac muscles potency depressed with increased thyroid hormone levels because of continuous excessive protein catabolism. As the protein catabolism increases, it decreases the heart potency to contract properly. Atrial fibrillation is the major cardiac complication of hyperthyroidism. As the thyroid hormone levels increases, of course, the atrial fibrillation results. But and it was reported that the hyperthyroidism is about, in hyperthyroidism, the prevalence of atrial fibrillation is 15%. But there is very few studies which has been conducted which states that how much in euthyroid subjects what is the prevalence of atrial fibrillation. Thyroid hormones in euthyroid and atrial fibrillation patients also neglected, and that is important hormone with reference to the heart rate and the cardiac output. So this study was conducted in order to evaluate the levels of T3, T4 and TSH in euthyroid atrial fibrillation patients. They are atrial fibrillated, but they are euthyroid, they are not suffering from any thyroid problems. For that purpose, a study was conducted. It is a case control study. We have selected some atrial fibrillated patients and we compare it with the control subjects. For that purpose, the control and healthy, we collected 100 individuals, which was divided into the two groups, atrial fibrillated group and the control group. And it was selected with the help of the physicians on the basis, they are recorded on the basis of the ECG. Now just coming to the, we have studied the different parameters, that was systolic blood pressure, diastolic heart rate, and ultimate PT3 and T4 and TSH was measured with the help of the ELISA, which was carried out in Lahore College for Women University. Now, while carrying the study, we have just collected the information from the subjects, and it was noted that 14 subjects were suffering out of 75 who had the family history of the heart disease, while the remaining have no history of the heart diseases. According to the atrial fibrillated subjects, they are divided into the three groups. As they are shown, they are the three types of atrial fibrillations which are reported by the subjects. And regarding the demographic and biochemical parameters of the two groups, it was observed that the only difference which was observed, significant difference was observed in the triglyceride levels between the control and the atrial fibrillation groups. Other lipid profile parameters are normal. No doubt there are the difference, but the significance difference was only observed in the triglycerides level. Regarding the T3, T4, TSH, TSH was decreased, as you can see from the bar graph. They are decreased in the AFF group, and as the TSH levels are decreased, that indicates that the T4 has been increased in the atrial fibrillated group. The T3 was also decreased in the AF group, but the T3-T4 ratio adds in the sideway group that has been also decreased, which indicates that the, even they are the euthyroid subjects, they are not suffering from any thyroid disorder, but the thyroid function has been altered because of the heart problems. So the major risks that are associated with the prevalence of atrial fibrillation was the diastolic blood pressure, heart rate, the T3-T4 ratio and T4. It means that the high levels of T4 hormones was observed, which may be a significant problem in the atrial fibrillated patients, because as they have developed the atrial fibrillation, their thyroid profile have been changed. Thank you. We have determined free T4 and free T3 by ELISA. We measured with the help of the commercially available kits, with the help of the DAD kits, we measured the free T3 and free T4 which was present in the blood. I just shot down the methodology. In methodology, we have mentioned that we have taken the blood samples and then measured the blood, these parameters.
Now, I would like to invite our second speaker of this session, Dr. Humaira Khan from Lahore College for Women University. The topic of her presentation is immunosuppressive potential of loxoprofen in albino mice. Please welcome Dr. Humaira Khan.
First of all, I want to thanks to Department of Zoology and Department of Biotechnology and their respective heads to invite me over here and give me privilege to present my work over here. I'm basically a pharmacist, and for me, a drug is a molecule that can alter your whole body mechanism. It's a very original thing in our pharmacy that every drug is a poison and every poison is a drug, and it's a dose that differentiate the both. But now it has been changed. Every drug, every chemical may be poisonous on other parts of the system. So here, I worked on the NSAIDs. NSAIDs are, we classify them into two types, COX-1 and COX-2. And we all know about the aspirin, mefenamic acids, and loxoprofen is among one of those. Loxoprofen I choose because it is very much abundantly used in pain of the arthritis and rheumatism, which is very common now among females and males in Pakistan. It is a non-selective inhibitor of COX-1 and COX-2, and definitely inhibits the prostaglandin synthesis in the body. Along with the inhibition of COX-1 and COX-2, it is also found to be, through the literature, it is immunosuppressive. By what? Inhibiting the prostaglandin E2 enzyme, it is also an anti-inflammatory effect along with immunosuppressive effect. We classify the immunosuppressants that we commonly used among different diseases to reduce the autoimmune rejection systems, along with, as we know, the immunostimulants. Immunostimulants we need where we want to enhance the immunity of our patients, as in cancer. Immunosuppressants we used where we want to reduce the autoimmune rejection system, where the transplants or grafting of certain tissues is required. Both of the conditions, the painkillers are being used extensively in our society like a hotcake, and everybody has this sort of any type of anti-inflammatory at home. But before choosing any anti-inflammatory, you must remember whether it is not disturbing your other systems or not. I here focused on cell-mediated immune system, that's delayed hypersensitivity and cyclophosphamide-induced assay, humoral immune assay, heme agglutination assay, and mice lethality assay. This is a flow chart that it's made for to assess. Delayed hypersensitivity assay is done, and the grouping is done A, B, C, D. Here I use cyclophosphamide because it is a known immunosuppressant, and it is a very good anti-cancer mustard drug, but it is also a very known immunosuppressive effect. So I used it here as a positive control. The Nazarene. Loxapropin was, we have to move. This is a late type hypersensitivity. At the end of the day, DNCB, dinitrochlorobenzene, I used as a sensitizer on two different days. It increased the thickness of the skin. But when we treat our group with the loxapropin at two different doses, that is 32 mg per kg and 64 mg per kg, because it's in the literature as well in the pharmaceutical preparation, the commonly used loxapropin is 60 mg human dose. Skin thickness was measured after the period of after the period of 24 hours, 48 hours, and 72 hours. Here the other way is cyclophosphamide model. And as we know that cyclophosphamide is an immunosuppressant, so it causes thrombocytopenia by suppressing the stem cells in the humoral immune system. Heme agglutination assay, this is again done to know about the titer, and we know that the titer is known with the serum antibodies presentation when exposed to certain antigens. Mice lethality assay, it is again done with the toxins. First they are exposed with certain vaccines. Here we are being exposed the mice with the HS vaccines, that is hemorrhagic septicemia vaccine, and afterward we expose them with the toxoid, that is multisodia toxoids. And by the reduction in the mice lethality, we can calculate the defensive mechanism of that. It's a thickness score, and we have seen that on 72 hours, after 72 hours, the loxapropin group 64 mg per kg reduced the thickness, but not as compared to normal group. This is the leukocyte count. Here we can see that at the dose of 64 mg per kg, the leukocyte count was not as much increased as that of normal after cyclophosphamide administration. Again, the mean value hemagglutination titer. Here we can see that the value of the loxapropin 64 is 8 plus minus 2.29. That's not so experienceable as compared to negative control. Mortality percentage, here it's a very promising result. The 50% of the mice died after 64 mg per kg dose. It was really revealed that loxapropin is immunosuppressant at the dose 64 mg per kg in experimental groups. It suppressed both immune systems. Exact mechanism is unknown, but it might be due to the inhibition of cyclooxygenase enzyme that inhibit the PGE2. Recommendations, It may be used autoimmune diseases and organic organ transplantation. Thank you very much.
The topic of our presentation is remains of Giraffa Priscilla from the Upper Shinji Formation of Lower Sivaliks, Northern Pakistan. Please welcome Dr. Kiran Aftab.
Bismillah Rahman Rahim. Assalamu alaikum. I'm Dr. Kiran Aftab, and the presentation is remains of Giraffa Priscilla from the Upper Shinji Formation of Lower Sivaliks, Northern Pakistan. Actually, the Sivalik Hills are the range of hills to the northwesterly limits of sub-Himalayas. It includes the area between Attock in Pakistan, Shimla Hill in India, as well as Potohar. The Potohar lies between the sub-Himalayas and salt range in Pakistan. Towards east, it extended along the eastern bank of River Jhelum. And towards west, Indus River has a definite boundary. These hills are also present in Nepal and Bhutan. Sivalik Hills are divided into three subgroups, which are Upper Sivaliks, Middle Sivaliks, and Lower Sivaliks. Lower Sivaliks comprises Kamlial and Chinji formation, and the age of Lower Sivaliks is from 18.3 million years to 11.2 million years ago. And Middle Sivaliks consist of Nagri and Dhok Pathan formation, and the age of Middle Sivalik is from 11.2 to 3.4 million years ago. While Upper Sivalik consists of Son formation, and the age of Upper Sivalik is 3.4 to 0.6 million years ago. These species of giraffe have been already described from the Lower Sivaliks of Pakistan. These are Pro-Giraffa sivalensis, Giraffocarix gingiensis, Giraffocarix punjabiensis, and Giraffa priscilla. I collected my material from three localities of Lower Sivaliks of Pakistan, which are Bhilomar, Pararewala, and Ratyal. The age of these localities are 11.2 to 12.2 million years ago. This is the map which shows all of my localities, and these are the picture of my localities. This is Pararewala, Bhilomar, and Ratyal. Upper Chinji formation is about 2300 feet in thickness. It consists of siltstone and sandstones. Siltstone is mainly brownish to yellowish and grayish to tan, while sandstone layers are bluish gray to brownish gray, and the clay is bright red in color. The main core of my work is to generate new information of the Lower Sivalik giraffids in the Upper Chinji formation of Pakistan. The Upper Chinji Sivalik giraffid fauna is then compared to the related non-Sivalik African, Asian, and European faunas. And the paleoecology of the Upper Chinji Sivalik giraffids are then updated. The study consists of these phases: materials, measurements, comparison, photography, and tooth morphology. This material comprises different types of dentitions, and after that I compare this material with the specimens present in the American Museum of Natural History, New York, Indian Museum, Kolkata, Punjab University Paleontological Collection stored in Zoology Department, University of the Punjab, Lahore, Pakistan. Giraffa priscilla can be differentiated from other Lower Sivalik giraffid genera on the basis of some distinguished characters, which are: crown is comparatively broad, enamel is very thick, and spur is absent in anterior fossae. Similarly, styles and stylets are very strong and pillar-like, and medium ribs in the teeth are very prominent. These are the results. I have collected many specimens of Giraffa priscilla from these three localities. Giraffa priscilla is endemic to the Chinji formation of Siwalik and it is unknown from outside this region. This species also have been recognized from the Indian Middle Miocene locality of Ramnagar. Giraffa priscilla could not survive with large giraffids and disappear before the onset of Dhok-Pathan formation. Now only two living genera and species are present, which are present in Africa. These are Giraffa camelopardalis and Okapi johnstoni. The presence of calcite in paleosol confirms that at that time Lower Siwalik consists of moderate rainfall fauna. Similarly, some bovids, swids and listrodon are also present, which indicate that there was a mixture of woodland and grassland biome. Some rhinos are also present at that time, which indicate that there are more rivers and lakes. So Giraffa priscilla is known only from the Chinji formation of Lower Siwalik. Then I compare the Lower Siwalik fauna with African, European and Asian faunas. And Lower Siwalik paleo environment was wet and humid, having extensive forests and dwarfed grassy lands. Thank you.
Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. First of all, I am Aisha Badar. Currently, I am a student of Foreman Christian College University. And earlier, I was in Kinnaird College where I conducted this research of mine. The title is Assessment of Serum Hypersensitive C-Reactive Protein Levels in the Patients of Vitiligo, particularly that of Pakistan, and the evaluation of their mode of life in our current society. Okay, I think I have to fast forward my presentation. First of all, let me introduce you to my topic. Vitiligo, as we all know, it is a skin depigmentation disorder in which the melanocytes of our skin stop producing the skin pigment, which gives the brown color to our skin. So white patches appear on our skin. Here you can see the hands of a vitiligo patient. The white patches are clearly visible. So this is the morphology of the skin of a vitiligo patient. What I did in this research was I calculated the concentrations of the C-reactive protein, which is an acute phase protein, and the concentration of this protein is known to exceed in the blood of, in the serum of the vitiligo patients. So I calculated the and correlated this increased concentration with the disease condition of vitiligo. The second aspect of my research was the assessment of the quality of life of vitiligo patients in Pakistan. I used the Dermatology Life Quality Index questionnaire for the assessment, and then I evaluated that to what extent the this disease of vitiligo affects the lives of the people of Pakistan. The major purpose of my research was first to analyze and correlate the concentration of HSCRP with the vitiligo condition. And unfortunately, vitiligo is not a basis of widespread research in Pakistan. Only a few articles have been published in this regard, and those are related to the genetics of vitiligo, not the physiology of vitiligo disease. So this would be a step forward for further research, and it would provide better aspects for the doctors and researchers to find the cure for this disease, as there is no cure found for this disease. There were four major objectives. First of all, I had to identify the patients of vitiligo from Pakistan. Then I calculated the effect of vitiligo using the DLQI questionnaire. And lastly, I measured the HSCRP concentration qualitatively and semi-quantitatively. All right, let's move on with the literature review. I think this is the old slides you uploaded. Right. First of all, I enrolled patients according to a specifically chosen selection criteria from major government hospitals, and Services Institute was a major hospital. The consent of patients were obtained, and their blood was sampled. They were asked to fill the DLQI questionnaire, and their score was analyzed. The serum was separated from their blood and was stored, and it was subjected to the CRP agglutination test. The CRP agglutination test was split in two ways, qualitative determination and semi-quantitative determination. In qualitative, here you can see this representation is that of the Humatex kit slide. It is a glass slide and this shows the orientation of the cells. Each sample was reacted with the latex reagent which contained the antibodies, and every sample which gave a positive result in the qualitative test was subjected to the semi-quantitative determination, where a formula was used for the quantitative calculation of the concentration of CRP in each protein, in each sample. All the demographical parameters were tested statistically using the software SPSS, and the parameters included demographical parameters, body composition, the DLQI score questionnaire, and the qualitative and quantitative test results. Okay, here this table shows the results for the score obtained by each of the vitiligo patient. This graph shows that the DLQI score works in a way that the person who gains a score of 0 to 1 has no effect at all of vitiligo on the quality of their life, and those who obtain 21 to 30 score, they have an extremely large effect of vitiligo on their life. So it was found that 53 of our respondents had moderate effect on their life. 23 had very large effect, 7.69% had extremely large effect of vitiligo on their lives. It affected in a way that it affected their marital relations. There were respondents who got divorced because of these diseases, and they had many issues with their relationships because of this disease. I used the Pearson correlation test to correlate the DLQI score with the disease condition of vitiligo, and a p-value of 0 was obtained, which can be evolved that there is a direct relation and a very strong relationship between the two factors, and the vitiligo does affect the quality of life of vitiligo patients very negatively. This is the graphical representation of the qualitative CRP agglutination tests. 57.7% of the vitiligo patients gave positive results, which means they had a greater than 6 milligrams per liter concentration of CRP in their serum samples, and none of the controls gave positive results, which means they had a normal CRP concentration. This was the glass slide. The white specks show the presence of CRP greater than 6 milligrams per liter. Then the formula was used for the calculation of CRP in the serum samples, and the average CRP concentration was found to be 37, which is very, very much higher than the normal CRP. Here you can, it is a comparison of CRP concentration in the normal samples and the vitiligo samples. The green dots represent the risk of of the vitiligo patients. The red line is the normal concentration. The blue dots are the control samples which lie in the safe zone. However, the green dots are those from the vitiligo patients. So it shows that they lie in a risk zone. They have a very high concentration of CRP. Okay, these are the number of patients who gave positive results and their specific concentration. All right, then I used the Fisher exact test, and a p-value of 0 was obtained, which shows that there was a direct relation between the two factors. The concentration of CRP is very high in the blood of vitiligo patients. Finally, it was concluded from my results that the concentration of CRP is heightened in the patients of vitiligo, and their quality of life is very much affected by vitiligo in a very negative way. There were, of course, some limitations. The laboratory was not well supplied, and more time had to be spent on this. And definitely, a more cooperative attitude is required from the government hospitals in enrolling such patients. And a more cooperative attitude is also required from the physicians of such patients. They should be briefed that they should participate in such research. Actually, vitiligo is not the basis of widespread research in Pakistan. No such research has been carried out on the patients of Pakistan. So our major objective was just to find out that whether the concentration is raised in vitiligo or it is not. So we found out that it is raised in the concentration of people of Pakistan, because it may vary in the concentration of other populations as well. because vitiligo is an environmentally effective disease as well. So we concluded that the concentration remains high in such patients of people of Pakistan as well. Thank you so much for your time.
We have our last presentation. Actually, it was, where are you? I don't know the name of your topic, but you can come and give your presentation and tell it yourself.
Assalamu alaikum, I'm Komal Ahmed and I'm from Punjab University. My topic of presentation is cat analysis of antilope cervicapra, that is black buck, from three different environments for heavy metal accumulation. First of all, why I choose black buck? Because, okay sir, black bucks are native to India and Pakistan, where they were widespread in plain and open woodlands. Western deserts and northern mountains limited their distribution. Today, due to extensive hunting and habitat destruction, they are only restricted to a small native area, that is Punjab. Yes, sir. You all must be thinking that why I choose cat sampling instead of blood sampling, because while drawing the blood out of the animal, mainly due to stress, animal might die. So fecal samples are good bioindicators of gross heavy metal exposure, as it is less expensive or better mean of assessing long-term trends in pollution or other environmental changes without disturbing or killing any animal. These are the sampling sites from which I collected soil, water and cat samples. Bahawalpur Zoo represent the captive environment. Lal Sohandra ID25 represents semi-wild conditions, and Lal Sohandra ID65 represents wild conditions. These are some pictures from the ID25 representing black buck herds. These are from ID65. 15 samples of scat, water, and soil were collected from all these sites. Scat and soil samples were collected in a zipper bag, and water samples in 50 ml sampling bottles and saved in ice box for further analysis. These are the sample preparation. Firstly, 0.5 gram of the dry scat or soil samples were weighed and taken in the test tube, and concentrated nitric acid and perfluoric acid were added to it in 4:1 ratio. Then samples were kept in water bath for about 5 to 6 hours, or until they are completely digested and clear. To neutralize and dissolve the fat, 3 to 4 drops of hydrogen perchloride peroxide were added, and each sample were diluted further to 10 ml by adding deionized water in it, and then they were quantified for the heavy metal. This table shows the result of heavy metal accumulation in captive environment, semi-wild environment and wild environment. Now this graph shows the highest concentration in fecal matter were present in Bahawalpur Zoo, that is in captive environment. This graph shows the accumulation of heavy metal in water samples, which revealed that that copper and zinc were highest in semi-wild condition, that is Lal Sohandra RD25, while zinc and cadmium were highest in Bahawalpur Zoo. Soil sample revealed that the highest concentration of zinc were present in Lal Sohandra wild environment, that is RD65, while all other metals were higher in captive environments. The health impacts of exposure to these metals are maybe gastrointestinal infections, reproduction system dysfunction in reproduction system, chronic damage to nervous system, intestinal irritation, protein metabolism problems, arteriosclerosis, respiratory disorders, skin irritation, and even and death. SPS 16 software was used to analyze data. Data was found to be in distribution, non-normal distribution, because the value of P was less than 0.05. So we use alternative of one-way ANOVA, that is Kruskal-Wallis test, to determine the change in heavy metal accumulation with respect to the environment. Spearman's correlation was also applied by the help of principal component analysis. The sources of heavy metals were also pinpointed. Kruskal-Wallis test revealed that the zinc and cadmium copper concentration were changing with respect to the environment. Correlation revealed that lead and zinc have common source, as their p-value is less than 0.05, and zinc and copper were again changing with respect to the environment. Conclusion. To conclude, we can say that the Bahawalpur Zoo was considered to be a highly polluted site for lead, cadmium and copper in terms of fecal, water and soil samples, while high concentration of zinc were observed in soil samples of RD65, which is Lal Sohandra, which represent the wild conditions, and water samples of RDU25 when compared with the permissible levels. Through correlation, it was revealed that the zinc and copper were significantly different for each environment. PC analysis pointed the sources of heavy metal accumulation. That is, for Bahawalpur Zoo, the traffic was main reason of heavy metal accumulation in the feces, water and soil samples, while for RD25 and RD65, the contribution was made by soil resuspension and wind-blown dust. We can also say that this method of heavy metal bioaccumulation estimation is completely non-invasive one to conserve the wildlife. Thank you. Yes, ma'am, I've compared all the heavy metal results with the standard values of WHO and soil research institute's values, and it was revealed that the concentration of metals in Bahawalpur Zoo were higher than the permissible limits.
And why you use these four metals for the test?
Sorry?
These
four metals were chosen because in all the literature, because all previous reported articles also refer to these metals. These metals are more harmful to the wildlife as compared to other metals. That's why I've chosen these metals. No, ma'am, it is. No, ma'am, in very high concentrations, zinc is very, very lethal to animals. They may cause kidney and liver dysfunction and anemia. Yes, ma'am, no doubt, but excess of everything is wrong. That's why whenever the zinc is present in very, very high concentration, which was present in Bahawalpur Zoo, they may cause different symptoms and harmful effects.
Thank you so much.
And for conclusion, I have only two, three words. Number one is, I wish to say Professor Dr. Farhanda Manzoor and Professor Dr. Shugufta Naz to have this wonderful activity and to be here, create a seat for me to be here. I'm really thankful. Please give them a big hug. You know, such activities are the, you know, portrait of the institute. I'm really glad that LCU is taking lead in organizing such a wonderful conference there. I'm looking forward not only international speakers, but also speakers from all diverse areas of Pakistan. The people are coming from Gujarat, from Punjab University, from Kinnaird College, from all. So it's a big thing that you are having such researchers, students, academicians, and many companies. They are all together here in this hall. And I think this is a learning which you never learn in your classrooms, even if you study throughout the year. So this one time is a big learning, and I salute you, the organizers of this conference, for the successful execution. I would again request you all, because the presenters, they come for 5 minutes, but they prepare it for 1 year. You might be knowing. So please give them a big hand to all the presenters. There were some teachers, some students, so they did their best. I salute all of you, and I pray best for your life so that you may win in this life and thereafter also. So the last thing, because this is a lunch time and I don't want to be in the lunch, so the last thing, you allow me, I want to share that I'm going to organize another conference at Zhejiang, and Professor Dr. Farhanda Manzoor would be our invited speaker over there. So I wish that some post-grad students must be attending that conference also. The theme of that conference is very simple. It's a One Health concept. This is a very new idea, One Health. One Health means it's not only biology, it's not only zoology, it's not only botany, but it's not only environmental sciences, but basically it's the integration of all these subjects. To make that conference more elevated, more involvement, so we have arranged few more fun activities for the students, like there would be a competitions, like poster competition, there would be a speech competition, both in Urdu and English. And I request you,
that there must be a team coming from LCUW for competition in speech competition on one health concept. You can prepare some models, and there would be competition on sketch and what you call calligraphy. Over there would be a competition. Then there would be a live animal show. We would be giving you some live examples of One Health, some elite class animals, some elite class zoo animals, as well as dairy animals. We have a very good breeds of cattle, sheep, camel, and all those, even dogs, they would be there live. And not only this, after this, you all would be getting some interaction. We are expecting more than 30 universities throughout the Pakistan, starting from Aga Khan, Punjab University, Qaid Azam University, University of Peshawar, and we have three invited speakers from USA. The number one is Cornell, that is a big university you might be knowing, then is the Minnesota, then is another diagnostics. There is a diagnostic kit last minute. You might all be knowing that the PCR is the highest thing for the diagnostic tools nowadays. There is a company, they have a portable PCR machine, portable. You just take it to the farm, go there and detect that what type of protozoans or bacteria or whatever is there. And you will give it result within 5 minutes. Earlier, it was a study of 6 months. You will have to do this, and then you find. So now the things are coming, things are changing. Thank you very much. Once again, I pay a huge tribute to Professor Dr. Farhanda Manzoor and Professor Dr. Pavitra. Thank you very much. Thank you very much.
Thank you so very much. Lunch is ready to be served. And Professor Dr. Khurram, who is going to be with us on Skype. I would like to introduce you about Professor Dr. Tariq Javed. As I already told that his education is from, let us start it from here, yes. His education is from the master's he has done from Veterinary College and Veterinary Pathology. Doctorate in Veterinary Pathology from University of Agriculture, Faisalabad, and his postdoc in Public Health, Myobacteria from University of Spain. His research interests are to investigate prevailing food, animal, and poultry diseases, molecular epidemiology and pathophysiology of animals and poultry diseases, especially in myobacterial diseases, molecular biology used in diagnosis and investigating diseases of animals, development of diagnostic kits, in biological firm. He has published 5 books, 2 chapters in books published in USA. He has 94 research publications, 62 abstracts, congress, seminars, and databases, etc. He has 8 popular articles and reports. Let us put our hand together to invite Professor Dr. Tariq Javed for a lecture on association of 6 selected pathogenicity genes of Escherichia coli with gross and histopathological lesions in broiler chickens from field cases. Please welcome Professor Dr. Tariq Javed.
Ji, I will be giving you that too. This is your that. And
it on?
Yes, it was on.
Association of 6 selected pathogenicity of expression like with lesions in different organs of body of chicken. E. coli is a very important pathogen in systematic, and we must be very careful by the dealing with egg and meat at home, especially the woman. Because it is a chronic pattern, and can cause the food poisoning and the gastrointestinal kind of trouble. So therefore, it is very important. Now, this organism is a normal resident of gastrointestinal tract of chicken and human as well. I'm going to talk about the word E. coli strain. I'm going to talk about this avian pathogenic E. coli. It's so right. So there are different strains of E. coli, and there are from the PSI, and then they were confirmed by Krishna. And after confirmation, all the aspects we were selected for this gene transfer of genes, and the parameters used for targeting the genes were selected from previous studies carried out in different parts of the world. So, what we found? We found that Siegen regions, they were present in maximum number of birds on the liver. Liver is the main target organ. Liver and heart, they are the main target organ as for E. coli cancer in chicken. But intestine, spleen, and other organs, they can also be affected, and they are also affected. So mainly our target was the liver, and we they were present in maximum number of birds on both, I think, in both spleen, liver and heart, and they were mixedly distributed as for spleen or intestine is concerned. In fact, intestine had also quite a good number of birds and spleen. What we found, the spleen circulated and the shrimp farm, which we studied, faint C was present in almost all the isolates. In almost all the isolates, those were recovered from dead shrimps, from the bird sample. ESS was another gene that was present in 80% of the strains circulating in our environment, and IUCD gene, it was present in 72%. FOU 60% cases, DAC 48% cases, and F2 in 32% of cases. So we found that frequency, PSS, IUCD, and FOU rate, they were major genes present in our strain, circulating in our environment. So, but this study was an interesting finding that was not in our way. We did not plan really, but we found that targeting these genes, they also helped us to have strain type. That's how many types of strains they are present in our environment. That was quite interesting finding, which we occurred. And on the basis of the data, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, so all 17 strains we identified, they were actually present. Now, these 17 became more than that because we just selected DNA parts. So if we can go for other areas, these strains may be more than that. So at least we found there are 17 different strains who were circulated in our environment. And what we found? That frequency gene and PSS gene, they were recovered from highest number of cases, and the severity of the agent, they were highly related with including IUCD. The severity of the agent was highly associated with the presence of these three genes, frequency, PSS, and IUCD. So the other genes were also associated with lesions, but our finding was this. That was in liver, and this is in heart. Again, the frequency, TSH, and IUCD, they were in highest number. So mostly we found that these are the genes which are more prevalent in our strain, and they are highly associated with the severity of patients in the chicken. In this time, when there were variable lesion, we went 36%, it was around 60% or 56% in liver and different CPS and IUC, they were the major change in the world as for submitting your patient in the time to us. So this is a slide of the zero, always the main target. Without even isolating the change in your data, we can directly the disease in both in chicken. But just looking on the data, if we see a wide effect over the data,
thank you so much. I would like to call two of our very prestigious scientists here for co-chairing with Professor Dr. Tariq. Dr. Humaira Majid from Institute of Pharmacology, Lahore College for Women University, please. Moving forward, we have a Skype conversation of Professor Dr. Khurram Shahzad from University of Heidelberg, Germany. A brief introduction about Dr. Khurram Shahzad. He has done his doctorate and postdoc from Germany and USA. He is currently working as a senior scientist at Heidelberg University, Germany. His doctorate was in cardiovascular diseases, and he's right now working on coagulation of cardiovascular deceptions like atherosclerosis, myocardial infarctions, and diabetes. His today's talk is also on diabetes. He has published many articles in international and national journals of high impact factors. His talk is going to be on targeting epigenetically sustained P66 SHE reservoirs, accelerated atherosclerosis in diabetes. Sir, can you hear us? It's a video lecture. All right, it's a video conference.
Question arises, why are the rules of the average patient different as compared to the Different These errors most carried by pathology on suicide and cirrhosis rather than depend on expression in the memory itself. Next, to confirm the crucial pathogen role of these in the habits of associated atherosclerosis and determine whether these inside may be of translation of the elements we use and determine the process. We should have a device with view of our own, which is a tool in mind of the view to hold by the situation. After 16 weeks of
and this is certain procedure where you lie in the depth of the heart. And it is my life to be done by the key and so we try to get an experience and then offer an experience and the desire for the whole month. This is really good. By the heart and then my partner and I have 24 hours. And we start. There are no paths, but in the control of the other mind, there are quick paths, which is imparted. Similarly, see, you can not in the path side. Similarly, you can never receive its own type of directive, and then involve the separate function in the head, that it is only one for what is that, when you reach the path side. So, this is actually the effect in this.
Speaker presentations. I would again like to make that comment that we are running short of time. So please be concise, focus on your objectives, results, and conclusions, that what you concluded out of your study. Do not tell details about the methodology. It will really be kind of all for all of you. Let's start. The time limit is 5 minutes for each.
I would like to call Ms. Sara Junaid from Punjab University, Lahore, to present cyanobacteria and microalgae role in development of biofuels. Please welcome Ms. Sara Junaid.
I am Sara Junaid, and here I'm going to present the topic comparative assessment of biodiesel production from microalgae. So first of all, what is cyanobacteria? These are the prokaryotic photosynthetic microorganisms. They are also known as blue-green algae, while the other microorganism is the microalgae, and it is eukaryote. So these organisms are very astonishing because from their biomass we obtain the biodiesel, biomethane, as well as biohydrogen and bioethanol. Now, what is biodiesel? Actually, biodiesel is monoalkyl esters or long chain fatty acids, and there are different generations of biodiesels. So first, second and third generation. First generation biodiesel was obtained from the food crops, while the second generation biodiesel was obtained from the non-food crops. But there were some drawbacks of these generations, that's why we moved towards the third generation, which is cyanobacteria and microalgae. Now what happens that these microorganisms, they obtain sunlight, water and carbon dioxide from the environment, and then they produce the lipid bodies within their cells, and we extract these lipid bodies and we transform it into the biodiesel. The goals are sample collection, strains isolation and purification, as well as characterization and identification and screening of hyperlipid producing strains, quantification and the quality of the fatty acid, as well as the cultivation of these best hyperlipid producing strains on the mass scale. The sampling was done from the different geographic regions of the Pakistan, including the northern areas as well as the Punjab University. So after that, we move towards the isolation and purification. So here are two different methods for the unicellular strains isolation and the filamentous strains. So here is the mechanism mentioned how we purify the strains. Here is the summary of all the results of the strains. Like there were 12 samples, and we obtained the different unicellular and the filamentous strains from the different regions of the Pakistan. So here is the table in which number wise and the presence of the strains in each sample is mentioned. Now come towards the characterization and the identification. So it was done by the different parameters, including the morphological characters, molecular methods, physiological, chemical, and the culturing conditions. On the basis of their morphology, the unicellular strains were differentiated on these parameters. Like here are the 8 different parameters which were observed. And for the filamentous strains, these parameters were observed for their differentiation. Now come towards the genetic identification. For this, first of all, the DNA was isolated, and then it was sequenced, and the sequence was then it was performed the blast analysis, and then the these sequences were submitted to the NCBI and got the accession numbers. Here is the summary in actual of my whole research work, that these are the all the isolates of the cyanobacteria, and here are the number of the isolates which were obtained in from each sample. Here is the result of the microalgae strains. Like there is the name of all the microalgae, and here's the number showing the number of isolates which were obtained from the each sample.
When the strains were obtained, then they were grown for the production of the lipids, and different conditions were used for their growth, like the on lab scale, different nitrate conditions and different media were used, as well as in the natural conditions were also followed. So different types of media was used for their growth, BG11 media, BG11 with the different nitrate concentrations, as well as modified media prepared by ourselves to prepare the mass growth of the cyanobacteria and microalgae. Now come towards the actual point of the research work, that how we extract the lipids. So here is the focusing point, like the process of the transesterification. What is the process? In this process, the fatty acids or the lipids which are present in the microorganism, they are extracted and then they are converted to the biodiesel. So transesterification is the main focusing point. So here is the equation, that how the triglycerides are converted into the methyl esters. Here are the results, like biodiesel was obtained from the consortia, like they were not isolated and they were grown all together. So here is the result. These results are biodiesel per biomass ratio. So the more promising results are highlighting. And these biodiesel was also obtained from the filamentous isolates, and unicellular isolates also gave the more promising results in the case of the highlighted strains. Second, the biodiesel was also obtained from the different obtained from the different modified media. So this strain oscillatoria, it shows the most promising result. And biodiesel was also obtained from the different nitrate concentrations. And Sudan black staining was performed to stain the lipids. So different types of the lipids were stained in this staining. And FTIR analysis was also performed for the detection of the lipids. Now come towards the conclusion. Like our main focus was to screen the hyperlipid oil producing strains, as well as here is the results of the more promising strains. And there was an equal efficiency of biodiesel production, which was in the case of isolates and when they were grown in the field. So the future perspectives are to screen the more biofuel producing strains and their mass cultivation, as well as to obtain the high biodiesel quality. So I would acknowledge to my supervisor, Dr. Mehboob Ahmed, and the chairperson of MMG department, Punjab University, Professor Dr. Anjum Naseem Sabri, as well as chairperson Dr. Atiya Iqbal of MMG department, the Women University, Multan, and I am also acknowledged to my colleague, Sahar Mehboob. So thank you.
Is there any questions? Tamra Sadiq, on behalf of Dr. Kafil Ahmed from University of Sargodha campus. She will be giving us a talk on evaluation of hazardous elements, accumulation in wheat variety irrigated with ground and sewage water implications for public health. Please welcome.
Evaluation of hazardous elements accumulated in wheat variety Galaxy irrigated with ground and sewage water implication for public health. First of all, introduction, wheat for human, wheat is the most important element. Wheat is the major. Evaluation of a hazardous element accumulated in wheat variety Galaxy irrigated with ground and sewage water implication for public health. For human, wheat is the main source of major nutrient, as it supplies 70% starch, 12% protein, 2% fat, 12% water and 1.8% mineral. Commonly, wheat production on world level is 3,210 kg per hectare, whereas in Pakistan, wheat production is 2,787 kg per hectare. In 2012-13, 24.2 million ton of wheat was cultivated on 8.69 million hectare, showing that 2,787 kg per each hectare, which regulating harvest in zone of 13.2% of growth. It is contributed 10.1% of country budget and 2.2% of gross domestic production. Wheat yield is at a risk due to subbiotic factors such as rust foliar disease, mellitus, and abiotic factor, temperature, moisture, salt stress. Water is the most important element for plant, and it is the major abiotic regulating variable for the growth of plant, also required for the improvement of growth and comparatively affect the growth, harvesting and the yield of plant. For plant growth, sodium, potassium, phosphorus are the basic nutrients required in a higher concentration. These minerals are found in wastewater in very high concentration. Wastewater affects severely wheat by accumulation of heavy metal. The requirement to evaluate the possible risk through accumulation of high concentration of metal in wheat. It is a key role of investigation of present research to measure the metals in wheat which are irrigated with wastewater in relation to public health. Material methods. The current study was conducted at University College of Agriculture, University of Sargodha in 2014-15.
What is the method, Renuga? Please let me results.
The concentration of lead, zinc, nickel, iron, copper and chromium or cadmium. Water shows significant result as the result of analysis of variance. But in a soil, iron and zinc show the non-significant result and other metals show significant result. All the metals which are present in grain show the non-significant result. When the concentration of wastewater increases, then the concentration of metal is also increased. But it is this experiment is a short-term experiment. If we use continuous wastewater for irrigation purpose, then the concentration of a heavy metal is increased day by day, and which is toxic for human health. Then find out the correlation. Positive correlation demonstrates that strong relationship between soil and grain, but negative relationship demonstrates the weak relation. In present study, copper showed the positive non-significant correlation, whereas the other metals such as chromium, nickel, zinc and lead show the negative non-significant correlation. Bioconcentration factor, cadmium show the highest concentration bioconcentration factor, but as the copper show the lowest concentration factor. Pollution load index. Here, chromium and zinc show the lowest pollution load index, while cadmium show the highest pollution load index. Daily intake of metal. In this parameter, copper show the lowest daily intake of metal, and iron and cadmium and zinc show highest in daily intake of metal. Health risk index. Chromium show the lowest health risk index and cadmium show the highest health risk index. Enrichment factor, copper show the lowest enrichment factor while lead show highest in present study. Conclusion, irrigation with the polluted water may contaminate readily the soil and cultivated land. The accumulation of heavy metals from soil to plant vary according to metal and treatment. However, they did not follow any particular.
Assalamu alaikum. The topic I'm going to present over here is biotransfer of cobalt along soil, plant, chicken food chain implication to public health. First of all, introduction, what are heavy metals? Elements having the atomic weight between 63.5 grams to 200.5 grams and having specific gravity greater than 4 are called heavy metals. In biological processes, heavy metals play a vital role, but their concentration do not exceed limits. Heavy metals are the components, heavy metals are generally not biodegradable and their biological half-lives are so long, so because of these properties, they tend to accumulate in the tissues of living organisms where they may cause a superfluous effect. In soil, heavy metals are present naturally, but various anthropogenic and geological activities increases the amount of these heavy metals to the extent that are very toxic to animal and plants. Sewage water is a potential source for the contamination of environment with heavy metals. Irrigation practice is a more addition of water to soil in order to meet the plant needs to overcome drought condition and as well as to improve its yield. Crops are mostly irrigated with municipal or industrial wastewater in peri-urban and urban areas. Food chain contamination with heavy metals is one of the major root of entrance of toxic heavy metals into an animal system, and to check the bioavailability of these metals in polluted soil has produced a major concern. The major aim of the study was to determine the transfer of cobalt from diverse water sources to soil, from soil to growing plant, and from plant parts to chickens in two experiments conducted in two different seasons. Materials and methods, these are four varieties, corn varieties, that were the Pearl, Sahiwal 2002, MMRI and Sadaf were grown in plastic bags containing soil. After emergence, plants were irrigated with sewage canal in groundwaters. On maturity, the grains of this crop were
used as a feed for chickens. Chickens were separately allocated according to the corn grains they were consumed with respect to water. Samples of water, soil, grain, shoot, root, and chicken body parts were prepared by using wet digestion method, and they were analyzed by using atomic absorption spectrophotometer.
Just one minute. Please take your mobile away from the microphone. Thank you.
Pollution is indices, enrichment factor, pollution load index, bioconcentration factor, bioaccumulation factor, translocation factor, and target hazard coefficient were also determined. Results: sewage water and sewage water irrigated soil samples show the high concentration of cobalt in it as compared to soil samples and the water samples, the soil irrigated with canal water and groundwater. Similarly, the plant parts, all plant parts showed, those that were irrigated with sewage water showed the high concentration as compared to those plants that were irrigated with groundwater and canal water. The trend was same for all plants irrespective of the treatment and varieties. The root accumulate the high concentration of cobalt in it, followed by shoot, and the least was observed in grains. In those group of chickens that were reared on grains obtained from the plants that were irrigated with sewage water showed the high concentration of cobalt in it compared to those chickens that were reared on grains that were obtained from the plants irrigated with groundwater and canal water. Enrichment factor was found out by using the formula delineated by Al-Hawati Al-Hashwan 2014, and the enrichment factor values were also higher for sewage irrigated soil samples as compared to canal water and groundwater irrigated soil samples. Pollution load index value was also high for sewage water compared to other sources. Bioconcentration factor, bioaccumulation factor, and translocation factor. Bioconcentration factor is actually the values that we obtained by the formula. It is actually the concentration or transfer of a cobalt from a soil to the edible portion that were grain. Bioaccumulation factor, that is a transfer of cobalt from soil to shoot, and translocation factor from root to the shoot, that is within a plant. All the values were less than one. Target hazard quotient. Values were less than one, which indicated that exposed population is unlikely to experience obvious adverse effect on utilization of that poultry edibles. Conclusion: a linear increase in cobalt concentration was observed in 7 body parts of chicken that consumed grains raised with sewage water in their diet, as the concentration of cobalt was higher in those grains that were irrigated with sewage water compared to other sources. Target hazard quotient values for cobalt were less than one for meat, liver, and gizzard, indicated that export population is unlikely to experience obvious adverse effects on utilization of these poultry edibles. Wastewater was applied to experimental plants only for short duration of time, and also chickens were reared on these grains for shorter duration, but the results could be more pronounced if wastewater raised grains were given to them for longer duration. Sewage water was responsible for the transfer of considerable amount of cobalt in soil, plant, and chicken, as this study may also help to establish a baseline data regarding environmental and food chain safety and suitability of sewage irrigation in future crop production. Suggestion for further work: other cereal crops such as wheat, rice should be cultivated in order to appraise the transfer of heavy metals from sewage water to the grain of these crops. Fodder irrigation with sewage water should be cultivated in order to appraise the level of the transfer of heavy metals from fodder to ruminants. In place of chickens, many other birds can also be incorporated in such type of studies like pigeons and sparrows. Thank you.
For the remover of malachite green, please welcome Dr. Rahat Nasir.
A very good evening. By the end of the session, when I was here in my alma mater, I narrated many stories about how I will go to the stage and welcome there. Lekin by the end of the day, and taking apology from our Chinese guest, sirf ghalib ka ek sher hi bol sakti hu. के जो भी आवे है नज़दीक ही बैठे हैं तेरे, हम कहाँ तक तेरे पहलू से सरकते जाएं. तो 5 मिनट मुझे दिए ऑडियंस ने,
And the topic of my presentation is the potential of rice husk and rice husk ash for the removal of the malachite green. This is the small portion of our big project in which we are trying to develop a multi-process algorithms for the bioconversions. This is one portion of that project in which we have, you know, two things in abundance. One is pollution and the other is the waste product. So we try to combine these two things into one and try to explore. Ji madam.
Ji ji. Okay.
आगे पीछे कर दीजिए
और ये लेफ्ट राइट.
ओके. सो द एग्रीकल्चर वेस्ट वी हैव मैनी एज पाकिस्तान इज एन इंडस्ट्रियल कंट्री यू नो एग्रीकल्चर कंट्री यूज टू बी द 75% ऑफ द लैंड वॉज द एग्रीकल्चर बट नाउ एवरीथिंग फ्रॉम द क्रॉप रेजिड्यूज टू योर किचन वेस्ट एवरीथिंग इज अ इंडस्ट्री considered as the agriculture waste and we try to develop and the technology has reached into at this extent that there are no more terms as a waste. So they are nowadays referring themselves as an agriculture byproducts. And the second is the azo dyes which makes your and my clothes colorful and extensively used in the agriculture in the industrial processes. As there is no mechanism in the Pakistan for the treatment of the industrial wastes and the effluents are drained into the your water bodies. So there is a need of the time that we should develop a practical mechanism to treat these azo dyes. Malachite green is one of the toughest dyes, said to be the toughest dye. And we try to remove this dye with the help of the rice husk and rice husk ash. Why we use this rice husk and rice husk ash? As ash is the byproduct of the gasification plants, which is used to be in the brick making industries. As far as the rice husk is concerned, there still poses a disposable problems for the farmers. So we used this agriculture waste for the removal of the malachite green. We develop kinetic models for their removal, and I am not going to into the detail of all these removals, but we prepared and we modify rice husk with the help of the alkali to increase its adsorption sites. Then with after that we prepared and converted it into the activated carbon, and then we use these two materials after their characterizations with the help of the FTIR and the SAM analysis. We conducted the batch studies and we also developed the equilibrium kinetics models for these data, and the two isotherms we plotted. Ultimately, what we find that rice husk has a more potential for the adsorption as compared to rice husk ash. It was a little bit surprise for us, as we are expecting more adsorption from the rice husk ash as compared to the rice husk. But husk found to be a very good absorbent, and now we are developing to reduce it amount to such a level that a minimum amount of the husk could be used to clean a large amount of the water. That's the problem where our basic research lacks with the practical and the applied connection with the industry, because industry doesn't like to have a tons of husk for the removal of the azo dyes. But if by some way we are able to reduce and minimize the amount of the adsorbent, that in this way we can relate our research from basic to applied, number one, and from the lab level to the practicals level. And this is the conclusion of this small portion of our study. And I hope that in the future, we will try to develop a model in which we can use a minimum amount of the rice husk to completely remove the azo dyes from the
effluent drainage. Thank you very much.
In different varieties of wheat grains irrigated with different sources of water. Please welcome Ms. Asma Zafar.
Assalamu alaikum. My name is Asma Zafar, PhD scholar from Sargodha University. The topic which I'm going to present today is bioaccumulation of heavy metals in wheat irrigated with sewage water. First of all, introduction. Wheat belongs to family Poaceae. Wheat is the first important strategic cereal crop for the majority of Pakistan population. It is the most important staple food of about 2 billion people. Worldwide, wheat provides 55% carbohydrate and 20% food calories consumed globally. Pakistan is an arid to semi-arid country and facing a problem of clean water shortage because the population of country increasing very rapidly. Therefore, farmers have to utilize wastewater as an alternative of clean water, and this trend is increased with the passage of time. Sewage and industrial wastewater is continually used for irrigation of agriculture fields in developing countries, including India. Continuous use of wastewater leads to the enrichment of soil with essential macro and micronutrients. Several micronutrients are heavy metals and are known to produce undesirable effects at higher concentration. Accumulation of toxic heavy metals leads to the stress condition in plant system by interfering with their metabolic activities and physiological functioning of the plants. Aims and objective. The aim of my study is to check whether the wastewater show metal toxicity in wheat or not. Objective of my study is to estimate the concentration of water, heavy metal in water, to explore the concentration of metal in soil, to evaluate the concentration of metal in different wheat parts collected from various districts, and to evaluate the various pollution indices. Material and method. The current research was carried out to investigate the effect of heavy metal present in sewage water on wheat variety Sahar 2006. Sample of variety were collected from various districts which is irrigated with sewage water. Sample was prepared by using wet digestion method in order to assess the concerned metal by using atomic absorption spectrophotometer. Also, pollution indices were also checked: pollution load index, bioconcentration factor, bioaccumulation factor, translocation factor, and health risk index. Results. Our results show that in water, in sewage water, zinc show the maximum concentration while nickel is present at lowest concentration. The same trend is observed for soil, like zinc at higher concentration and nickel at lower concentration. But for root, the concentration of zinc is increased, which shows its high mobility, while here the copper is present at lower concentration. For shoot, the trend is same as for the root. For grains, the zinc is present at higher concentration, but here the lead is present at lower concentration, which shows its lower mobility to the edible portion of the wheat. Pollution indices. The results of the pollution indices show that all the pollution indices have the concentration less than 1, except for pollution load index of cadmium and for the bioaccumulation factor for nickel, which have the value more than 1, which may pose health risk. Conclusion. In present study, the use of wastewater affected the concentration of heavy metals in all parts of the wheat, which may have health risks. So there is a need to give more awareness to the farmers in regard of using sewage water for the agriculture purpose.
Assalamu alaikum. I am Sabiha Habib from University of the Punjab. The topic of my presentation is bioremediation potential of chromium resistant bacteria. Heavy metal toxicity in soil is of great concern, as soil is the medium of plant and plants are the primary source of food for humans as well as for animals. Chromium is regarded as the second most abundant metal in earth crust. Chromium toxicity in soil causes inhibition of photosynthesis, nutrient imbalance, reduction in pigment and protein content, reduction in fresh weight and inhibition of microbial activities in soil. There have been several chemical and biological approaches that have been introduced to reduce chromium toxicity, among which bioremediation is regarded as one of the useful and practical techniques. The basic objective of my research work is to introduce an eco-friendly and sustainable agricultural technique to reduce the chromium toxicity and to understand the importance of chromium-resistant microbes, especially bacteria, against chromium stress for the improvement of plants. I have selected four bacterial strains which are very efficient in oxygen production and chromium tolerance. And then I have conducted a plant growth experiment with Zia maize, and different growth parameters and biochemical parameters were observed. Now coming towards the results. This graph is showing is the effect of bacterial inoculation on shoot length of Zia maize under chromium stress. I have used three different concentration of chromium, 200, 400 and 600 microgram per ml. In control treatment, you can see that shoot length of the plants is getting reduced due to the chromium toxicity, while the effect of bacterial inoculation can be seen in other graphs. And same in the case of root length, the root length was reduced due to chromium toxicity, but bacterial treatments have helped increase in the root length. And the number of leaves, due to chromium toxicity, not only the number of leaves are reduced, but also the size and area of the leaves are reduced. But bacterial inoculation helped to increase in the number of leaves. And fresh weight in control treatment, when the plants were grown under chromium stress, the fresh weight is reduced, while bacterial treatments help to increase the fresh weight and biomass of the plants. The biochemical parameters were also observed, that is chromium, chlorophyll content and protein content. Here is the graph of chlorophyll A content. Same trend was shown in chlorophyll B and total chlorophyll content. Chlorophyll is very important for photosynthesis. So bacterial inoculation, when the bacterial inoculation is done for the plants, the chlorophyll content was increased. And here is the graph of protein content. In control treatment, the chromium toxicity reduced the protein content, while in bacterial inoculation, the protein content was increased. Basically, the bacteria produce oxygen, and oxygen are involved in the cellular division and differentiation that result in the expansion of the cells and ultimately enhance the plant growth. Similarly, here is the mechanism of biological nitrogen fixation as well as siderophore production and insolubilization of phosphate that bacteria involved in this. Now, concluding my presentation, results of the present study have shown bioremediation potential of chromium-resistant bacteria to minimize the toxic effects of chromium, thereby improving overall plant growth as manifested by the enhancements observed in the various growth and biochemical parameters of treated plants. Well, this is all about my presentation. Thanks to all of you.
Therefore, let's begin and use the report. So, chromium-resistant bacteria including India and US, it's this aspect of the case, based on life strategies. The only problem with this one is patients having this indication that they by day wake up in the morning and they urinate, the urine turns black. And that's because of the hemorrhagic of the RBCs. Because RBCs, they don't have a seafood, the diabetes are surface, they cannot perform the physiological functions. So, and the reason is because those patients, they have the DKT inhibition. They have the
was my colleague who tried this to develop it as a team relation.
It was a convincing data, obviously, so we were very encouraged. Then, yes, is the health, environment, and science. The SEC seems to flourish as a substitute, and they have a department and science institutions. That is a good one.
Okay, let's have a third.
Siegen is not speech or represent the entire language. So this event is the same as that. In the top two slides, as I mentioned previously, we have to address the directory, that is part of the party, and we start and we did the process of the internet. So the top two slides are the top. The top two slides are where this is the entire part, this is the publisher there. So, it is the department, it is the department, the local department, that is starting to assess the students. The other department is a smart publisher and how to process the standard to the size, which is an individual publisher and services. We do have, this is their own kind of limitation, they don't need any other communities, but they do have such a kind of hard and design task. That's a special thing. So based on that principle, we can differentiate between the data size, which is the publisher and the services. So an example cycle plan on the left side is and on the left side, the right side, so looking at these two sides, you can see that the difference in those are the two dots in the shift in color, but they are the modification. But if you look at the long pattern, and the left side, and on the right side, this is the most important part of the long, it is the most specifically in the world. It is very sensitive, and it is differentiated between other active ingredients and individual resistance. We give you, for example, farm specific and receive for farm diagnostic program. We know you can smart for the special drugs, we don't have to send the patient. You can keep those animal plasma as you want, and you just you just take one drop of blood from those animals to not test them. It's a specific procedure, it's a specific step.
अभी ओके बोल चाहिए अभी भी
Any questions?
Yeah, sure.
Any questions, please?
What is the basic difference between these?
would be a big part of the company, it is systemic exposure and not just going to do a matter of our time. But we can run that as the benefit of that. But for the purpose of that, you should have that in the first 4 years. We, as, like something you do, I'm looking at our company, we are seeing that company, our company is going to run out of the idea, it's actually the
purpose
of the idea. So that is what is my opinion. Assume, but in possibility, as the father.